In terms of health care, further, the bottom line is that as a nation, we have to ask ourselves why we spend 40% more than the Canadians per capita, and the Canadians provide quality and comprehensive care to every person in that country, why we spend double what they do in Japan and Germany, countries that also provide universal care to all of their people. How does that happen? And the answer, I think, has to do with the fact that our system is extremely inefficient. It is inefficient because we tolerate the existence of 1,500 private insurance companies. Now, let me break the bad news to you, if you don't know it already. If some of you think that the function of an insurance company is to provide health care, wrong. I don't know how to break this bad news to you, but the real function of an insurance company is to make money. I know it comes as a shock, but it's the fact. And what that means is you have situations where insurance companies are delighted to provide reasonably costed insurance to young people who promise never to get sick. God forbid you are an older person and you've had, you know, breast cancer, if you had back problems or so forth and so on, they're not particularly interested in insuring you because, in fact, you might need the insurance. And that's, they don't make money doing that. But the whole problem, it's not only the obscenity of not insuring people with pre-existing conditions, but the greater obscenity is that with 1,500 private insurance companies, each one jockeying for their own position in the sun, trying to make some money, you have created a massive bureaucracy which is wasting, according to various government studies, about $100 billion a year out of the $900 billion that we're currently spending. Why is that? And the answer is that we have, all of America spends half their lives filling out forms. All right, when you get sick, and there was a woman, I remember the Vermont State Legislature, a woman had a PhD. Her husband was a physician. They could not figure out how to fill out the forms for her mother. I mean, the forms, people have to spend their lives filling out the forms. Doctors have to hire people to help them fill out the forms. You have people in the basements of every hospital in America sitting in the computers billing you, you know, to get money from you that you can't afford to pay, and they're arguing with you on line 14, were you covered or were you not covered. Now, not only is that obscene from a moral point of view, it is extraordinarily wasteful from an economic point of view. What we want to do, if we spend money and somebody gets sick, we want to spend the money to have our medical people make that person whole again. We don't object to spending money for that purpose. But I think we do object to spending $100 million a year to have people push paper and drive everybody crazy so the insurance companies can make their money. And I'll tell you something, even the doctors. And in Vermont, we have many rural doctors who are sympathetic to single payer. And the reason is they're sick and tired of pushing paper and hiring people to push paper. They would like to actually practice medicine and not push the paper. So that's one major advantage of the single-payer system. It is simple. And in its simplicity, it saves huge sums of money. The second advantage of the single-payer is that it allows us to negotiate with people who need to be negotiated with. If you look, one of the interesting things, if you look, and you should understand that in Canada, there is no real national program. Each province has its own program. But if you go up into Ontario, for example, and you look at how much a coronary bypass might cost, or an appendectomy, or an office visit, and compare it to what exists in this town, what you'll find is that in many instances, it costs 50% in Canada as to what it costs here. And that's because the fees are regulated. Doctors cannot charge anything they want. There is a process by which the fees are negotiated, and if a doctor charges more than that, that doctor goes to jail. There is global budgeting of hospitals. Also, dear to my own heart, there is an ability to negotiate with some of the major crooks in America, and that is the people who head the pharmaceutical industry. Some of you may be aware of studies which show that the cost of prescription drugs in this country, manufactured in this country, are double, three times what they are in Europe or in Canada or in Mexico. And the reason for that is countries with real national health care systems are able to negotiate with the drug companies and say to the drug companies, if you want to do business in this province, in this country, you're going to have to charge us a reasonable rate. If not, goodbye. And they do get the reasonable rates. In this country, the drug companies get, by and large, what they can, what the market will bear. and many of our people, including our elderly people, that hurts me the most because, you know, elderly people get sicker than other people, are paying very, very high prices for drugs. And in my own state, every day that I go to a senior citizen center, people tell us that they're taking money out of their food budget or their heat, winter heat budget in order to pay for the prescription drugs. So you can save money through the single payer in terms of bureaucracy, eliminating the bureaucracy and all the waste there, and also in an ongoing cost control mechanism, cost containment mechanism. It is a very simple system. What you get is a card, like a credit card or like your own card, your Blue Cross card right now. And with that card, you go to any doctor you want. You have freedom of choice with regard to doctors. Go to any doctor you want. You give the doctor the card. The doctor then sends the bill to the public authority. In fact, gets paid quite quickly, and that's it. You don't fill out forms. And doctors like it, patients like it, and in fact, it ends up saving a whole lot of money. Now, I have no doubt that many of you have seen on television and the newspapers all of the terrible things that are happening in Canada. My God, it's amazing the country is still alive. And what you should appreciate is that that is nothing more than a lot of slander. The Canadian system is not a perfect system, and it has its problems. And Canada right now, as you know, is undergoing very, very serious economic problems, very high unemployment, a lot of indebtedness. It's a country which has, like the United States, serious economic problems. But their health care system is immensely popular. Every poll that has been done shows widespread support among the people. The physicians support their health care system. Didn't always, but they do right now. And when they do polls in Canada, and they do a poll, they say, well, would you like to go back to the system from which you came, the American system, go back to do it the way they do it in the good old USA? They did a poll not so long ago, and 3% of the people thought it would be a good idea to go back to the American way. And what somebody told me, you should put that into a perspective of understanding that 6% of the Canadians think that Elvis is alive and well. So I would say that that suggests that there's widespread support. You have three major political parties in Canada. The Liberal Party won a few months ago a sweeping election. And all the parties are supportive. You know, one thing about a politician is a politician wants to get reelected. Right? That's true in Canada. It's true in America. And you had, as a funny story, I'll tell you a funny story. A couple of years ago, when the Conservatives in Canada were in power, there's a group, a Republican group in the Congress, the moderate Republicans, called the Ripton Society. And they invited a representative from the Canadian embassy to talk about the healthcare system. And I sent a member of my staff to go to the meeting. And the staff member came back and says, God, Republicans were really pissed off at the Canadian ambassador. Because here they had this conservative guy, not the ambassador, but somebody from the embassy. Here you had this conservative guy, and the Republicans thought they were going to have a kindred soul who would tell them how terrible the Canadian system was. And yet this conservative spoke with a great deal of pride and support of the Canadian healthcare system, which got many of the Republicans very, very angry.